to go and go to boarding school, which is what they did often in those days. And the letters between the headmaster and his parents talk about the fact that he was a good student. But he was shy and backwards and awkward. And the letters actually say, you can read it today, they actually say he would probably never amount to anything. James Madison. In that same year, 1764, there was a guy who had just graduated from Harvard. He got married that year. He was so excited. He was became an attorney, and he got the farm. And he said, he wrote in his diary, I'm never going to leave my home again. John Adams. Is that what happened to John Adams? Well, he spent half his life away from his wife and family. In 1764, these guys had done nothing up to this point to warrant the title Founding Father. They hadn't done anything. In fact, they were very much like who? Us. They had relationship problems. They had money problems. They had health issues. They had dreams that were unfulfilled. They had all kinds of things. I know this may sound unusual for you, but the Founding Fathers were not genetically superior to us. They were very much like us. However, a little more than a decade after this time, they got together with others and they declared independence from the greatest military power on the planet. A decade after that, they wrote a constitution, a form of government, that has provided more freedom for more people for a longer period of time than any other form of government created by the hand of man on this planet. But in 1764, they were just regular people. So how do you go, and you have to include their wives, sorry. There's Martha, Martha, Dolly, and Abigail. How do you take regular Janes and Joes, regular people, and turn them to American founding fathers and mothers? How do you do that? Well, that's a question I asked, and I studied this, and here's what I found. I found that during this period of time, we had two things that are different than today. We had a very, very different kind of educational system then, and we had a very different culture then. Everything I've studied from 1650 to 1950 of this period of time tells me one thing. If you want a citizenry of character, if you want men who are responsible for their families, if you want women who take upon themselves the roles of mother and grandmother seriously, if you want citizens who will stand up for the country and provide for themselves without a handout, if you want people who will join together in communities during hard times and not require the government to help them but hold themselves, if you want all that stuff in a society, guess what? You have to teach it. You can't give it in a pill, a little bottle, a little shot in the arm. You can't give them a summary, a video. It doesn't work. You have to teach it. And who's the best ones to teach it? Yeah. Interesting, isn't it? Now, when the founders set up the form of government they gave us, they made a couple assumptions. They said, you know, here, I got this little pointer thing. I think I'll use it. They said, if we're going to have freedom and liberty in a successful government that we're giving you, you have to have three things. And at the time, we had these three things. They said, if you lose these three things, you can't keep the government we gave you. Jefferson, it was Franklin who came out of the convention, and the lady said, what form of government have you given us, Dr. Franklin? And he said, madam, a republic, madam, if you can keep it. He meant these things. The founder said, to keep the form of government that they gave us, we would have to be highly educated, self-regulating, and not dependent on the government. Today, one in six Americans is on welfare. Could we get a bigger bang for our buck? There's a lady in South Chicago doing this right. Well, I haven't talked to her lately, but she's been doing this since the 70s. Her name is Marva Collins. Anybody familiar with Marva Collins? Oh, my hero. She's doing this in South of Chicago. She was a school teacher, and she found all the kind of stuff I'm telling you happened, and she said, wait a second, we got to change this. No, we can't change this. She said, okay, forget you, and she started her own school. And she's proven that you give kids self-respect, and you love them, and you're consistent with them, they will rise to whatever standards you give them, no matter where they come from. We have a political problem in this country. We have a cultural problem in this country, and you cannot solve cultural problems with political answers. You get that? When a family breaks up, when a marriage breaks up, that can have devastating impact. I was going to give you some solutions that would solve the national problems we have in America today. Well, it's the restoration of the four lost American ideals. So let's go over them real fast.
If somebody will teach you how to think and you have confidence in yourself, you can get out of any situation if you know how to think, if you know how to use this.
Frederick Douglass is one of my greatest examples of this. He said he didn't know he was a slave. He grew up in slavery. He didn't know he was a slave until he accidentally learned how to read. And from reading books, he all of a sudden dawned on him, wait a second, that white guy thinks he owns me. And as soon as that occurred to him, he said, I don't think so. It wasn't long before Frederick Douglass was free, because he said, I'm a free man inside here. Right? That's what happens when you teach people how to think. Thousands of farmers walked into their fields ready to harvest corn, grain, and they lit a match to their fields and burned them to the ground so the British could not benefit from it, and walked off into hunger. That's public virtue. I could stand here and tell you story after story after story of that time period of public virtue. I can't tell you too many stories of modern America. Without public virtue, a nation cannot stand. Makes us think, doesn't it? We stop and we think, we go home, we cry, we pray to God for Him, but it causes us to step up and makes us do just a little bit better the next time. You see how that works? That leans toward liberty. Otherwise, we turn inward and we turn selfish and we don't care about what happens to other people, and that causes us to lose liberty. Think of it this way. We are at a place right now to impact the next 10 to 15 generations of our children. That's what we're talking about here. Our children. So here's my challenge. My challenge to you is to become liber. My challenge to you is to have Georgics in your life, to live by providence, and to exemplify public virtue. Really what I'm asking you to do, I'm challenging you to be American.